Yes.
That sounds good. Hotep. Brothers and sisters, you're now standing at a model of the greatest temple on the planet Earth, going back over 4,000 years ago. When we think of churches, when we think of synagogues and mosques, this lays the foundation. This is the prototype. So even the Western architectural structure of the church gets its design from right here. These great Nisus of the Middle Kingdom, they are the ones who started to build onto the Temple of Amun to honor Amun, who this temple is dedicated to. In fact, we can see that walking into the temple, you're going into a time capsule. The great Nisus who started to build this temple, like Imteps, the Menahets, the Senhorets, all the Nisus built onto the temple. And let's not forget about the Queen Makari Hatshepsut. As we were saying before, these beckonets that the Greeks referred to as pylons, here the last one right here is built by Taharqa. Even though you might watch the history channels and discovery channels and they will talk about this great temple, not one word will be mentioned of this Cushite African named Taharqa, who's in the Bible, by the way, who they don't even mention that he was the last one to build this beckonet right here, that the Greeks, as I said, refers to as pylons. Then we see other beckonets as we go back in time, whether we're dealing with Ramesu I, Seti I, who started the hypostyle hall and led into his son, Ursula Agras and Tepe Rawa Mesu Mari Amun. I mean, that brother put a name on him. So again, we see the sacred lake, the Shah Netcha, where the world's first baptism took place at long before John the Baptist. These tekenus that you see right here, in fact, there were said to be 64 tekenus right here in this temple alone. And now we see there are only two that we see of Makari Hatshepsut and also her father, Menkheperatu, who he made the first to bring the city. Welcome to the greatest temple on the planet Earth, dedicated to the spiritual deity God, and that is Amun, and the temple called Amun Ipet Asut, the most select and holy of places. Here we see the whole foundation of theological, also philosophical thought, all coming from here, where students had to go to school for 40 years. When I, in the lecture, talked about and showed you a sketch of Solomon's temple, by the way, that you can't find anywhere. They said it used to be here, but the temple of Amun Ipet Asut is right here. All the way in the back is the Ankh-Menut, or the holies of the holies. Here in ancient times, our ancestors would take the Ark of Amun out from the holies of holies, and this large alabaster stone that you see right here, the Ark would be placed on top of this alabaster stone right here. During the time of the Opet festival, that was a great time period that our ancestors honored Amun. And right here on the side is Ursima Atras of Tepera Mesumari Amun with his wife down by him, and that is Nefertari II. It does not show that he's macho, but it's showing that in order for you to come to the nation, okay, you got to come through him, okay, if you're going to touch her. So that shows his protection. But again, here we see this is the grand Baba of all the temples. So we're going to continue our procession into the temple. Looking at the nave of the temple, you'll see the Ankh-Menu where the ark was carried out in the procession. But what I want you to look at, I want you to look at the nave of the temple. I want you to look at the architectural structure of the temple.
Because even though we don't know this, what we do know is Solomon's temple. Even though there's no representation on earth of Solomon's temple, what you get is a sketch. There's no sketches here. For instance, here's the hypostyle hall, here's the holies of the holies, and here's an ark, the Ark of the Covenant. We know the Ark of the Covenant, but when you do that comparison and see Solomon on the side here, but wait a minute, here you see the temple right here. This is the real thing. And even though brothers are in the craft and talk about the temple of Solomon and know nothing about the temple of Ipet, all they get is a sketch in a book of the temple. Solomon's temple, if he lived, was 900 years BC. This temple is over 4,000 years ago. This is real, this is unreal. They give you a sketch. But this, you can find it, but most brothers in the lodge know nothing about Ipet. You say Ipet, what are you talking about? Temple of Amun? When are we going to be grandmasters and travel back here to the northeast corner where you are right now to get the light of the world, where the light of the knowledge came from ancient Egypt? Here is the Ark of Amun, the jet black spiritual deity, anthropomorphized, the cosmic energy of darkness, the cosmic energy of blackness. But wait a minute. When we look in the Bible, we see, and there I will meet with thee and I will commune with thee from above the mercy seat, from between the two cherubims which are upon the ark. Wait a minute, that's not Jehovah, that's Amun. The cherubims are the netter roots on the temple, brothers and sisters. Here's the Ark of the Covenant that we're most familiar with. The two cherubims like figures facing one another. This is the portable God house of Jehovah, where supposedly the tabernacle stones or the Ten Commandments were put in. But you're going to see that everywhere with the Kushite Kemetic gold shrine of King Tutankhamun's netter roots. That's everywhere, brothers and sisters. Of Aset and Nebhet. You see the spiritual ones in gold. So the Karihad priests carried the Ark of Amun. So here you got a sketch, another sketch. Here we see that the Israelites are carrying the Ark, okay, of Jehovah. There's no sketches here. It's the real thing. There's some of you who got the shaved head. I will ask you to stand in front of the massive Bekenu or pylon. And although it'll look as though you jump right off of the temple, because you're actually carrying the Ark of the black god Amun, as our ancestors did, the Karihabs. Now why did they have, why did I ask them to have their arms like this? Now look right above them. Uh-huh. Now look at the Karihab priest carrying the Ark of Amun. Uh-huh. They are carrying the black god of Amun, the black god of our ancestors from this great temple right here, Amun Ipet, the spiritual deity that we still say Amun at the end of our prayers. Can y'all carry the black god Amun?
Yes.
Can y'all carry the black god Amun?
Yes.
There we go. So they're carrying the black god Amun, and look right above them and you see the Karihab priest. See the Karihab priest with the shaved heads?
Yep.
So long before the Ark of the Covenant, it was the Ark of Amun, the Ark of Haru. What ark do you want? There are plenty of arks here. And our brothers are carrying the ark that we see them right here. It looks like they just jumped off the temple, doesn't it? I think this is the most Karihab brothers that we've had on the of all the trips. All y'all activated your ancestral genetic memory bank. All right. So this ark is heavy. I've had my arm here for a long time.
That's right.
Well, you got to carry the black god, brothers. We haven't carried the black god in a long time. All right. Now let's say amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen Ra.
Amen Ra.
Amen Ra.
Amen Ra.
Carrying the black god, amen.
Carrying
the black god, amen. Carrying the black god, amen. And try to give you an idea of how it was done as the Karihab priest carried that ark out of the temple. Here they carried in the most sacred and ceremonies that took place, carrying it from one temple to another temple. Because you're going to see it in the celebration of the Opet and the Netahets, the Ipet, tomorrow. You're going to see it right there on the temple on the side of the holies of the holies, brothers and sisters, and see that celebration of the Opet festival in the Netahet, the divine house of Ipet of Karnak, and the Karihab priest, where Menkheperatu-Hudimay is leading the procession to show to Amun that he's a king that can defend the holy place and defend the holy temple and the holy house. This is where you're going tonight. So when we come into the temple, there will always be ramps going up. That's how you know you're going into the holies of the holies, where the shrine, okay, of Ammon was put. And all temples had an ark, whether it's the Ark of Ammon, the Ark of Heru, the Ark of Aset, depending on what temple you're in. So here is the ark. You're going to witness one in the temple of Heru, where the priest, the Kari head priest, during the time of the Opet festival, this is the time of the inundation of the Nile, where they would actually take out the ark and go from one temple to the next temple. So out of the most holy place, they would carry that ark out of the temple to the next temple. So when you see the temple of Ipet, Isut, and the temple of Ipet, Isut, the priest would carry the ark from one temple to the other. So you're going to the smaller temple of Ipet, Isut tonight, but 2 miles away is the other temple, and they would walk in a whole procession to that next temple. The Netterhet, or the divine house of Ipet, Isut, called Luxor today. This is the African king, Neb-Ahtra Amenhotep III, around 1300 years BCE of the 18th dynasty, who built back onto the temple and reactivated the Opet festival and the ceremonies. This was the processional walkway where thousands of people would come out during the time of the Opet festival. And here they would carry that ark down that processional walkway for 2 miles. Now you're at the site. Now you're at the site that you've heard so much about. Those of us who've heard about the Ark of the Covenant and how the Ark of the Covenant was brought to Ethiopia with Menelik I. And this chapel right here is where the Ark of the Covenant is supposed to be. Those of us who are familiar with the Ark of the Covenant, that's where you see the Tablet. The Tablet or the Ten Commandments, where supposedly Jehovah God wrote the moral ethical codes. Thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not rob. But again, we cannot get stuck in one time. Many of us are locked into biblical stories and think this is the only story, and think this is the only sacred ark. The tradition of this ark is an ancient African story from the Nile Valley. It did not start in Jerusalem. It started in the Nile Valley. As I said before, that Tablet, supposedly Moses got on top of Mount Sinai, where Jehovah God wrote the Ten Commandments to him, right? Yeah. I have not robbed, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not kill. I keep saying thou shalt not because the original moral ethical laws were the laws of Ma'at. I have not robbed, I have not stolen, I have not killed. Originally 147, broken down to 42, where they literally took from the laws of Ma'at to make up the Ten Commandments. So we've got to get this, the whole historical chronology together, because sometimes we have a tendency, because we only know one story, we only get stuck on one story. And I've got to give a whole history. And some people talk about, well, it started in Babylon with Hammurabi. Well, the laws of Ma'at were also before Hammurabi as well. Okay, they predate Hammurabi. These are the moral ethical laws of Ma'at, represented by a goddess symbolized with a feather on her head, representing truth, justice, and righteousness. But as we see it today, associated with the biblical story is the Ark of the Covenant. And most of you know about the story of Indiana Jones, you know, and the search for the Ark of the Covenant and all these stories. But as we got the legendary story, it's now placed right here. Now, whether one believes that is part of belief system, and that's what religion is. If one believes it, that becomes your faith, you see? But when we're dealing with the legacy of the story, then we want to deal with the whole story. So I had to make that clear, because sometimes we think that these were the original stones, and these were the stories that on top of Mount Sinai or Mount Horeb, that these things actually took place. But they were mythologies based off of other stories that were started by your ancestors thousands of years ago. It's a Nile Valley story. It did not start in Jerusalem. African goddess took her feather that represents Ma'at. She's a cosmic goddess. It had to be weighed even with your heart. If it not weigh in balance, then Ammit would come out and get you. They knew you'd do some bad things, but long as your good deeds outweighed your bad deeds. And we see in the Bible in Proverbs, when you know your story, chapter 21, verse 1 and 3. The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, and the Lord weighs the heart. Do what is right and just. What is that? That is Ma'at, truth, justice, and righteousness that was taken from the Per-Emeru. When you go into the tombs tomorrow, you'll see the laws of Ma'at. I have not robbed, I have not stolen, I have not killed. The Nesubet, Neptui, Neb, Ma'at, Muri, Amun, Ra, Sarah. The king of Upper and Lower Egypt, who's the lord of the two lands. He's the lord of Ma'at. He's loved by Amun-Ra. Sa-Ra, he's the son of God. here in the ancient language of the Medu Netra, I have not robbed, I have not stolen. Here we see our brothers looking at the original moral ethical codes long before there was the Ten Commandments. The 42 laws of Ma'at, I have not committed sin, I have not committed robbery with violence, I have not stolen, I have not slain man or woman, I have not stolen food, I have not swindled offerings, I have not stolen from God, I have not told lies, I have not carried away food. 147 originally broken down to 42, and they pretty much said the same thing, but just like the judicial system or like a lawyer in a courtroom, they would say it a different way to trick you up to see if you're telling the truth.
Thank you.